We'll move on to questions without notice and member statements, and I will call Ms. Crazier.
Thank you, President. President, going to that issue that you've just been speaking about, my question is directed to the Attorney-General. Attorney, in today's media it is reported that Victoria's former IBAC Commissioner, the Honourable Robert Redlich, has accused the Andrews Labor government of revenge attacks in retaliation for a series of probes into its dealings. How does the Attorney-General determine that IBAC is afforded the respect and freedom to act as an independent entity to expose corruption when former esteemed IBAC Commissioner states that he witnessed this corruption by government members of the Integrity and Oversight Committee?
I'm just concerned, Ms. Crazier, it might be asking of an opinion. No. But can I bother you to read it out again, if it's okay?
The question is, in today's media, it is reported that Victoria's former IBAC Commissioner, the Honourable Robert Redlich, has accused the Andrews Labor government of revenge attacks in retaliation for a series of probes into its dealings. So the question to the Attorney is, how does the Attorney determine that IBAC is afforded the respect and freedom to act as an independent entity to expose corruption when former esteemed IBAC Commissioner states that he witnessed this corruption by government members of the Integrity and Oversight Committee?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And Ms. Crozier, you're confusing my role with the role of a parliamentary committee who has a statutory function in relation to oversight of the IBAC. IBAC Commission and its functions are provided for under legislation, and that guides the roles and responsibilities of that office. There is also the oversight of that body from the Victorian Inspectorate. And of course, Mr. Redlich, as in his capacity as former IBAC Commissioner, met regularly with me, and it's fair to say, as you would appreciate, giving his public commentary, that he wasn't shy in bringing forward his views in relation to his office, any requests that he made in relation to legislative changes, and all of those were acted on and presented to the department for advice. And I continue to have ongoing conversations with senior officials at IBAC on a regular basis in relation to how they undertake their functions.
Ms. Crozier, with supplementary
question. Well, thank you, President. Thanks, Attorney, for that response. And you, as you've just said, you do have regular conversations, so I do think you have oversight of this. Now, Mr. Redlich stated, and I quote, "IBAC's experience with the IOC, particularly in the last 12 months, evidences a lack of fairness, partisanship and leaking of information to the media," end quote. So, Attorney, what policy? What is the government doing to put in place that government MPs directed the independent auditors to find, and I quote, "find dirt on IBAC and data that is not readily publicly available"? What are you doing? Are you outraged that the government? Because I am. So what are you doing as a government, as the Attorney, in terms of direct the government MPs have directed the independent auditors, and I quote, "to find dirt on IBAC and data that is not readily publicly available"?
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Crozier. I'll call the minister.
Thank you, President. Ms. Crozier, from what I can take from the words that you used in that question. You were referring to a parliamentary committee, which as the Attorney General, I don't have a role in relation to. But any suggestion that anyone in the government has acted inappropriately is utterly rejected.
Mr. Edishank, on a question, thanks.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Agriculture, Ms. Tierney, and relates to grants for the hemp industry. Minister, yesterday my colleague Ms. Payne asked you a question in relation to a hemp grant scheme, highlighting in particular Western Australia, where the government has provided grants to local companies to drive the growth of the hemp industry. Your answer, though, yesterday, Minister, did not touch on grants at all. So quite specifically, Minister, will you contemplate a grant scheme to incentivise the Victorian hemp industry?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Edishank for his question for Ms. Tini, the Minister for Agriculture. Unfortunately, she's absent today, but I'll pass that question on to her in her office and get your response.
Mr. Edishank, supplementary.
I thank the Minister for her response. Funded projects under the West Australian Grant Scheme included seed and crop trials, establishing a hemp processing facility and building carbon-neutral homes from hemp biomass. Could you see similar projects being the recipient of grants here in Victoria?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And Mr. Edishak, I'll pass that on to Minister Tini, but as the former Minister for Agriculture, there are a range of grants that anybody that is a primary producer could access. And so some of the issues that you touched on might actually be eligible for existing grant programs, but I will let the now relevant Minister respond in more detail about any of the available grants that might pick up some of those projects that you talked about.
Minister Erdogan with the Minister's statement, please.
Thank you. I'm pleased to update the House on the work we're doing in our youth justice system by giving young people the skills and training they need to transition into meaningful employment upon their release from custody. Our government's priority is to keep Victorians safe and help young people turn their lives around. One of the best ways we can ensure their time in our care is productive is by training them with the skills and experience that will allow them to thrive in a professional work environment. Giving young people the training and confidence to secure and keep a job when they return to the community helps break the cycle of reoffending. The John Holland Graduate Program is a great example of putting this into practice. The program is led by Parkville College in collaboration with Youth Justice and provides young people at Parkville an opportunity to secure paid employment. The program offers formal, theory-based learning and development programs as well as practical on-the-job experience under the supervision of a senior staff member of the company. The program also offers the opportunity to network with senior leaders and the potential to secure ongoing employment with John Holland after the successful completion of the program. This is a great example of government and the private sector working together to create win-win outcomes, delivering not just a positive social impact, but an economic return. This program has seen a number of young people come through it and transition from short-term probationary work into full-time paid employment. Some are now working on the state's largest ever infrastructure projects as part of our big build. Projects that are helping to create jobs not just for these young people, but for everyone across our great state. Thank you.
Ms. Crozier.
Thank you very much, President. My question is again to the Attorney. Attorney, in the independent performance audits of the Independent Broad-Based Anti-Corruption Commission and the Victorian Inspectorate Minority Report, it is clear that the audits were not completed in a fair and independent manner. Rather, the Labor Committee Chair sought to interfere and direct the independent auditor contrary to convention and public expectation. So I ask, is it government policy that the Labor-dominated Integrity and Oversight Committee has interfered in an independent audit of IBAC and the Victorian Inspectorate?
I'm struggling a bit to see where that falls inside the Minister's administration. Ms. Crozier.
Point of order. President, these are really serious matters. The Attorney actually has responsibility for IBAC. This goes to the heart of... Yes, I know that, but in terms of your portfolio responsibility, you just said you had numerous conversations.
Yep.
This is about the integrity of what is going on in this place. And I ask around what has happened on that committee, and I would say that it does fairly fall in the Attorney's portfolio.
I can't see how the workings of that committee comes under the Attorney General's responsibility, but Ms. Crozier, I'm happy to put the question to the Attorney General in regards to her responsibility for IBAC.
Well, if I can just reiterate, in the general order of 5th of December 2022, it says the Attorney General is responsible for the Independent Broad-Based Anti-Corruption Commission Act 2011. So that's why I asked the question.
Well, I'm happy for anything relevant to the Attorney-General's administration if she'd like to respond to the question.
Thank you, President. Matters pertaining to parliamentary committees are a matter for the Parliament.
Yeah. Ms Crozier, a supplementary?
Attorney, disappointing that you won't have a proper response to this serious issue, so I ask the minority report of the performance audits recommends legislative changes to the IBACT Act and the Victorian Inspectorate Act legislative changes to ensure absolute independence for the auditor. Will the Attorney-General support this recommendation and when will she introduce legislation to do so?
Minister.
Thank you, President. We seem to have given a lot of weight to a minority report from politicians in relation to their views in relation to IBAC. It is, of course, important for me as the responsible... It is, of course, important for me as the responsible minister to listen to IBAC and others in relation to the functioning of IBAC and about the legislation of which they are overseen and operated, and of course I have regular conversations about this and I'll continue to do so.
Dr Mansfield with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Environment Minister, Minister Stitt. We understand that in order to go ahead with their enterprise gas drilling project near the 12 Apostles, Beach Energy needs to submit an environment plan to the Department of Jobs, Precincts and Regions under the Offshore Petroleum and Greenhouse Gas Storage Regulations 2021. We understand that this environment plan has not yet been submitted. Can you please let the House know why this is the case?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank Dr Mansfield for her question. This is actually a matter for the Minister for Energy and Resources in the other place, who I do actually represent in the Council. What I can advise is that I understand the Beach Energy project is still going through the required approvals, including an environmental plan, but I'm very happy to forward your specific question to Minister D'Ambrosio for a response in accordance with the standing orders.
Dr Mansfield, a supplementary?
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister representing the Minister for Resources for their answer. My supplementary question is, in the past, the process around how gas drilling projects are approved in Victoria has been very opaque, with very little community consultation, unclear processes for how decisions are made, and environment plans that have just been tick box exercises. As above, will the Minister guarantee that proper community consultation will happen before this project proceeds further?
Minister.
Oh, thank you, President. And similarly, Dr Mansfield, I'll refer your supplementary question to the relevant minister for a written response. Thank you.
Minister Blandfawn with the Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on what this government's $387 million investment in family services means for vulnerable families across our state. President, Family Services provide vital interventions and supports that improve parenting capacity, child safety and family functioning. Every day across the state, expert family service practitioners are working sensitively and purposefully with vulnerable families to provide the knowledge, skills and resources to get them back on their feet and stay on their feet. The case of Sean and James illustrates this well, and as always, I've changed the names to protect anonymity. Sean is a single father to 12-year-old James. James had experienced neglect while in the care of his mother as a younger child and has lived with his father for 4 years. Child Protection referred Sean and James to Family Services as they were concerned about James' limited engagement with school, his increase in anxiety and his escalating behaviour. Family service practitioners worked with Sean and James to undertake safety and care planning, strengthening their attachment and helping Sean to understand the impact of trauma on his son's brain. Sean was supported to use trauma-informed activities and strategies to help James. In addition, the family services practitioner integrated regular meetings between the school, James's psychologist and paediatrician, training for James' school on PTSD and its impacts on young people, planning for James' re-engagement with education, a discussion with his paediatrician around medication and an NDIS application, and the purchase of a swimming membership for James and Sean to promote connection, activity and recovery. So what's been the result for James? Sean reports that James is now experiencing less anxiety and has been able to follow the care team's plan. His medication has enabled him to manage his stress, anxiety and panic attacks, and he has followed the stepped plan to return to school. He's made strides in his recovery thanks to the supports put in place by family services practitioners. President, in 21-22, more than 12,500 families across Victoria access family services. We must always remember that behind each of these cases is a story of hardship and often trauma. It's why we're investing $387 million in family services, and it's why we, unlike those opposite, dedicate a cabinet portfolio to family services. It's for children like James.
Can I have Ms. Crozier a question, please?
Thank you. President, I again direct my question to the Leader of the Government. Minister, the former IBAC Commissioner stated in his letter to presiding officers, and I quote, IBAC's experience with the IOC, particularly in the last 12 months, evidences a lack of fairness, partisanship and leaking of information to the media. Will the Leader of the Government assure the Victorian community that IBAC will not be subjected to further interference from the Premier's private office?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Ms Crozier, they are views of a former commissioner and they're a matter for him. You've raised allegations that aren't necessarily proven, and I don't have a role in directing members of the IOC in relation to how they conduct their role. The only role I had in relation to that committee was proposing a motion in this House to appoint a member of this chamber to that committee. That's the only role that I have had in relation to the operation of that committee. So no, I will not be proposing that I interfere with the parliamentary committee's work. That would be incredibly inappropriate.
Ms Crozier, supplementary?
No, I've got it here, thank you. And what I want to ask the Leader of the Government again is, considering that it is the Parliament's, in line with the former IBAC Commission letter to presiding officers, will the Leader of the Government, as you just said, now urgently commit to changing the makeup of the Integrity and Oversight Committee membership to include a non-government chair and majority?
Minister.
Ms Crozier.
Minister, can you take your seat for a second? I seriously have a concern that the makeup of a committee and how that committee goes about its business is not within the Attorney General's administration. So if you want to call a point of order, Ms Crozier, I'm happy to hear it.
President, the Premier himself was asked about the makeup of the committee. So if the Premier has asked, and I'm asking Minister Symes as Leader of the Government.
Yeah, but that's outside of question time and that's at a doorstop, my understanding is. That's my understanding. Was there any other points of order?
The Minister clearly has responsibility for the Act, and the question was in respect to... No, not the committee, in respect to the Broad-Based Anti-Corruption Commission, and the question was in relation to that.
My concern is... there's a couple of concerns. It's the wrong act that Mr McGowan that you're quoting, but my concern is that if I set a precedent that ministers can answer questions around committee administration which has nothing to do with them, which people actually would be very upset if they thought that the ministers had some overriding the power or how they determine to do their work. So I'm not going to put the question. Can I go to Mrs. Tyrrell with a question, please?
Mr. President, my question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Health. In reference to this morning's Eastern Health announcement of an IT system outage and ensuring code yellow, even with no current evidence of a cyber attack, this highlights the undeniable fact that digital systems are vulnerable, which can have serious consequences for the provision of critical services and data management. Will the government acknowledge this threat and take proactive steps to address it, including investing in robust cybersecurity measures and contingency plans to ensure that essential services are not disrupted in the event of a cyber attack or system failure?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Mrs. Tyrrell, for the question. It's obviously a question for the Minister for Health, and so in accordance with the standing orders, I'll pass that on to her and ensure that she replies with in accordance with the standing orders.
Mrs. Tyrrell, supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. President. One more question. What steps are being taken?
Minister.
Sorry, President, thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Tyrrell, again for the question and obviously again for the Minister for Health, so I'll pass that aspect of the question on to her as well and ensure that you receive a reply within the standing orders.
Minister, stay with the Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President, and I was very pleased last week to announce the successful recipients of our $1.1 million Coastal Public Access and Risk Grant Program for 2022-23. The Andrews Labor Government is committed to ensuring that it's as easy and safe as possible for the community to access our spectacular beaches. But we also know that the marine and coastal environment is regularly changing due to the impacts of climate change, tides, storm surges, and other local conditions. And that's why, through this annual grant program, we're working together with land managers to identify and mitigate these risks to our coastline. Thanks to this funding, 16 important projects will be supported to deliver vital safety and access upgrades at coastal locations across our state, and this includes beach access improvements at Ocean Grove, Lawn, Marengo, Warrnambool, Sandy Point, Seaspray, Phillip Island, Parkdale, Middle Park and Blair Gowrie. We're also delivering funding for safety assessments and planning work for future improvements at Walkerville, a lovely spot, Dramana and White Cliffs, and new safety signage at Phillip Island Nature Park's beaches. Since 2014, President, more than $140 million has been invested into marine and coastal environmental projects across our state, supporting our statewide marine and coastal strategy and building the adaptation and resilience of Victoria's coastal communities for years to come.
Ms. Crozier, for the question, please.
Thank you very much, President. Well, these are serious issues, and you might laugh over these, but these are serious issues, and my question is to Minister Shing. Minister, were you ordered to gag the former IBAC Commissioner in order to protect Premier Daniel Andrews?
I also have concern that this is a question relating to what isn't the Minister's administration in this term. But I'm prepared to put the question. Minister, sorry.
Thank you, President. Without wanting to set any precedent along the lines of what you've just described as it relates to commentary on the execution of functions under the parliamentary committee structure, regulated as it is by the Parliamentary Committees Act and therefore regulated by the Parliament, I want to confirm to the House that I was asked this question this morning at the back of the Parliament, and I've been asked this question on a number of occasions before, and my answer has been on the public record in every instance whereby I've been asked this question, and the answer has always been no.
Ms. Crozier, supplementary?
Yes, that's right, Ms. Bath. Anne Frolic cutting the feed and doing what she did. Minister, given you admitted to acting alone in disgracefully gagging the IBAC Commissioner, how can Victorians trust that you manage your portfolios in a transparent and accountable way with the highest level of integrity when your track record shows that you interfered in anti-corruption investigations into the Premier?
I've got a problem with that one because it should be under a standing motion if you're going to make an allegation against a sitting member. And I'm not going to put it. I'm not going to put the question. I'm going to move to Minister... Ms. Purcell with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Agriculture. Every year, 12 million chicks are killed on their first day of life in Australia. Biologically, only female chicks can lay eggs, but statistically, around half of chicks born for the industry are male. After hatching, these chicks are put onto conveyor belts and sorted by sex. Currently, the standard industry practice to deal with the unwanted male chicks is to send that conveyor belt into an industrial-sized blender, where they mince alive in a practice known as chick shredding. In 2020, a parliamentary committee recommended that the government examine alternative practices with a view to adopting world's best practice. Despite government support for this recommendation, live chick maceration continues across Victoria, while other countries around the world adopt advanced pre-hatching technologies. Has the government conducted their examination into alternative practices to chick shredding?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Purcell for her question, and I'll pass that on to the Minister for Agriculture for a response.
Ms. Purcell, supplementary.
Thanks, President, and thanks, Minister Symes, for the referral. At the 2018 state election, the Andrews government made a commitment to modernise Victoria's animal protection laws. This is an instrument that could be used to end routine cruelty such as chick shredding, and it was recommended these laws be implemented urgently by the same parliamentary committee. 5 years on, we are yet to see this happen. Will the government introduce protections that stop the practice of macerating baby chickens alive in this legislation?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and again I thank Ms. Purcell for her supplementary question and her passion for this topic, and I'm sure that Mr. Tierney will be happy to engage with you on this and, in accordance with the standing orders, provide a response.
Minister Shigg with the Minister's statement, please.
Thank you very much, President. I rise today following International Women's Day to celebrate the work of women in water. Our water sector is extraordinarily progressive when it comes to inviting expressions of interest from women, encouraging women in pathways through professional development, through a range of different opportunities and programs, and then fostering a sense of momentum for the careers and the development of women in this sector. Many of the members here in this chamber will be well aware, whether they like it or not, of my passion for water and natural resource management and the role that women in water play. And I'm really proud of the work that we have achieved in this portfolio to ensure that we're delivering programs that have delivered 57% of board directors in our water corporations being women. That's 83 out of 146. And 61% of water corporation board chairpersons being women. That's 11 out of 18. At our catchment management authority, 61% of our CMA board members are women. That's 43 out of a total of 70. And 67% of our CMA board chairpersons are women too. And that is 6 out of 9. So what we need to do is to continue to develop this work. That includes our Insight program. It includes our Women in Water program. And there are so many other examples of the encouragement that's happening across the sector that are bearing very significant and positive results. Right now, though, board positions and applications are open for people to express interest in a board appointment to one of our Water Corp CMAs or the Victorian Environmental Water Holder. I would strongly encourage women and people from diverse backgrounds with a range of perspectives to apply for one of these positions. Your skill and experience lends a greater quality to decision making, and I would urge everyone to get on board.
That ends questions without notice and Minister's statements.